Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your most radical, extreme, extraordinarily favorite brother from another mother. Hallelujah, coming to you. Hallelujah, from the fabulous, extremely bodacious state of South Carolina. I can't think of a good word to describe it, but anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. Praise God through whom all blessings flow. I'm making this video. It's late on Sunday. I've been getting so many words from the Lord, and the Lord has had me doing lots of studying. So I haven't made any videos. I've been back from Florida for a day and a half now, or 2 days now. And I've been very busy doing lots of studying as the Lord is preparing me. And I have so many videos to make. You know, I haven't made a video about the orphanages or the feeding programs in a long time. You know, you guys, below every video, I always have a link to the Facebook group where I post pictures almost at least two or three times a week of the orphanages and the feeding programs. You know, and brothers and sisters, I need to make a new slideshow and just give an update and prayer request. But you know, as those of you who don't know who are new to my videos, because I haven't made a video in a long time, about every quarter or so, I make a video about the, we have three orphanages. We used to have four. We consolidated it to three. To make it more efficient and more cost effective and all that. So we have three orphanages in the Philippines, and we feed 1,000 poor children. And it's not really, the word is not street children. These kids who have families, but they live in little huts without electricity and running water and et cetera. And we do these feedings through three or four different churches. And on weekends, even Friday night, Saturdays and Sundays, they go out and do these feedings that we do. And then in the past, we, you know, someone gave a bunch of Christian children's books. And so we do, like, it's basically like a vacation Bible school. And then you teach them every time we go to these places, and we teach them, you know, the songs like Jesus Loves Me, etc. And, but in the local language too. And, we tell them about the Lord, and then we feed them, you know, teach them how to pray, etc. And then as a result of that, many of the families end up coming to the churches. You know, the pastors have a Bible study with the parents and the people in those little villages. And so praise the Lord, it's been very fruitful through several different churches. And then the three orphanages we have are spread out and separate from the feeding programs, but it's all part of the blessing that the Lord gave us that we call Joshua's ministry. So anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. Ask for your prayers for all that all the needs of the ministry be met. Brothers and sisters, the ways that people have helped us in the past, and it's all down below every video that I make. Description is in the Facebook group too. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just want to say that I just want to say this right now while I'm thinking about it. I want to thank all the people that's helped me to do the call of God for Joshua's ministry. You know, the orphanages, the feeding programs, I couldn't do it. You know, God has put it on people's heart. You know, some people are called by God to be the house parents. You know, we couldn't do it without the house parents. We couldn't do it without the person who oversees it. That's me. You know, you have to have someone who's the Lord is using to facilitate it. And then we couldn't do it without all the people that pray for the ministry. We couldn't do it without all the people that's donated. And some have prayed and donated. And then there's people have contacted me and said, you know, they you know, we sent boxes. People have sent boxes of children's clothes and school supplies for the orphans. And even we give away school supplies to the children at the 1,000 kids that we do these feeding programs in Vacation Bible School on a weekly basis with. And it's all, we're all a team, brothers and sisters. We're all one team. We all have the same. That's why I say, you know, you're a brother from another mother. We all have the same Father. Our Heavenly Father, all Christians, you know, all people that are born again Christians, we have one Father who is in heaven. As Jesus said, you have one Father who is in heaven. And even after the resurrection, the Lord said, you know, I have not ascended. He told Mary Magdalene, you know, don't keep trying to grab me and hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to my Father and your Father. And so we have the same glorious, great, holy, perfect, wonderful Father. I just want to thank God for God. You know, brothers and sisters, I was just thinking, I have so many things that the Lord's been showing me. Some of them are just, I was talking to our brother on Friday night, and I was telling him some things. I was about to make a video about it, but I ended up talking to this brother for a long time. Didn't make the video Friday night. So tired out from the trip to Florida. But, you know, the things that the Lord has shown me, just so awesome, but yet so simple. And all the time the Lord has shown me something. So I want to give you an example about trees. So I was going to even name this video, you know, Wisdom on Trees from the Lord. It's just so simple, brothers and sisters, but yet so profound. It's been two different times. One time in 2003, so it's been a long time ago. And then again, just Friday, the Lord was talking to me about trees. And so on Friday, I was going out, and I do prayer walks, and I actually run three times a week, like 5 miles. And then I've been doing that since I was 18, since I was in the Army. But I also do prayer walks on other days, too. And so I love to go out and, you know, in a place with trees, you know, natural areas. I love the outdoors and all that. And so that's the time I could, you know, really be alone with the Lord, too, besides just regular prayer in my prayer closet. But out and talking to the Lord, walking around. Sometimes the Lord will lead me to run into people that I could talk to about Him, whatever the Lord wants to do. So anyway, the Lord told me when I was going out there to this place, and the Lord, to the place that's in English, the name of the place is the Watchtower. I go out to this place, this park, and the Lord said, I want to show you something new about trees today. I was like, all right, Lord, because you showed me about trees in 2003. So you're going to show me something now. So I go out there, and the Lord said, while I was got out there, the Lord was talking about creation. You know, so that's really what I'm going to talk about a little bit about. You know, the heavens declare the glory of God. You know, it says in Romans chapter 1 that people are without excuse. Non-believers, even if they never heard the gospel. You know, they're without excuse to believe in God. You know, God holds people accountable for what they've heard and what they know. So someone that lived in the middle of the jungle, I've had people ask me this, you know, this is a hypothetical question of people used to make an excuse of why they're not saved. You know, and that's the whole problem. God knows the motive of their heart. So those people have got a problem because they're looking for a legal excuse. And they're like the lawyers in the Bible that challenged Jesus. So, you know, and tried to justify themselves. Who is my neighbor in the Gospels? So people say, well, what about someone who lives in the jungle in the middle of Africa, South America, and Ecuador, whatever, and they never heard the gospel? What about those people? God's going to send them to hell. The way it works is we're accountable for what we know, you know, and Paul says that, you know, people that are acting according to the morals of God, but don't have the law, they become a law unto themselves, you know, and people who are claim to be following the law, but they're not, see, they're lawless. So people can be lawless from what they know, or they can be within the law of what they know, you know, like all people know, it's written in our hearts from God, that murder is wrong. I mean, this is something that's into the consciousness of all men and all mankind that, you know, rape is wrong, murder is wrong, stealing is wrong. This is something that God put in our consciousness from birth. No one has to tell us that as an example, these extreme things, you know, all the, you know, gray areas of stuff. That's a different matter. But so God holds us accountable for what we know. So the Bible says to know to do right and don't do it is a sin. So with God, ignorance of the law is an excuse. Ignorant, and when I say the law, I don't necessarily mean the law of Moses. I'm talking about right and wrong, as I mentioned, killing somebody, like the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not kill, you know. So if you're in a war, you know, the real translation, just to, I'm saying FYI in this, to murder, it's really thou shalt not murder. Because in the law of Moses, God lays out how if two people get in a fight and somebody's accidentally killed, the person who accidentally killed them will flee to another city. They had these, God told Moses to set up these, you know, these safe haven cities that people could run to, sanctuary cities. They had sanctuary cities in the Bible where people who had killed someone could flee to that city. And then the relatives of the person they accidentally killed couldn't go there and kill them. Okay. And when they were in those sanctuary cities, but they had to flee town and run off to a sanctuary city. But people who are killed by accident when people are fighting or I accidentally run over someone with my car, or people will say, whack yourself, oh, you stepped on an ant. Thou shalt not kill, you stepped on an ant. No, it's talking about killing humans, and it's talking about killing them on purpose and not in self-defense. So the real translation there would be, thou shalt not murder, not thou shalt not kill. So as another example of people try to justify themselves by saying, oh, if you step on an ant, you're going to go to hell. No. It's talking about people and by on purpose to kill someone. And anyhow, and that's where we got in our American law came from the Old Testament and our Constitution. You go read what the American Founding Fathers wrote in their memoirs And the documents that they wrote, they talked about how they wrote the Constitution based off the law of Moses, really the structure of what's first, you know, and then the laws, the first laws of America and came from England and all that about, you know, what's first degree murder, you know, lying in wait to kill someone straight out of the law of Moses is first degree murder. Whereas opposed to accidentally killing someone, you know, like a manslaughter, whatever. Anyway, so brothers and sisters, God was telling me, see how I get on those rabbit hole trails? What can I tell you? But, well, what can I say, you know? But anyway, brothers and sisters, so the Lord was telling me about creation, that he made everything for man. God created everything, just like the stars. It's, what does it say? You know, God created us in his image, and God chose us to be above all the creatures. That's why people, this animal rights stuff is demonic. Why is animal rights is demonic in the fact that it's trying to make animals equal with man? And that's just like trying to make a man equal with God. Animals are not equal to us. Animals have their place. They're here to serve us. Dog is, you know, man's best friend. You know, cats kill mice. They give companionship. Dogs give companionship and all that. It's all great. We can have, our, you know, a lot of people, their children are grown or they never had children, they have dogs. And that is awesome. Dogs are can be our companions. Man's best friend, guard dog. Dogs can sniff drugs, bombs, etc. The dogs are awesome. Cats are, you know, finicky and weird, but some people love cats, you know. Well, in the Philippines, you have lots of rodents. And so, you know, that's why I appreciate cats, because if you have cats around your house, they'll kill the rodents. So I don't have a dog. So people that don't have dogs, all the cats are strays. The cats... Every house in the Philippines, unless you live in a hut in the middle of nowhere, if you live in any kind of a city area, everybody has walls around their house. And so in my house, I don't have any dogs, so the cats come and sleep on the walls around my house, and then they live there on the walls, and they eat. People put out scraps for them, or they find trash or whatever, and they eat. And it's like nobody owns them. So there's cats everywhere. And so since I don't have a dog, they come to my yard, and that's fine with me because there's lots of rats and all that kind of stuff. So I love the cats because of that, because of their job that God gave them to do. They destroy rodents. So thank the Lord for cats in the Philippines. But except for in the middle of the night when they're having their love affairs, they can be very annoying. You have to go chase them off. You know, they can be very loud. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the Lord was telling me that he created all of his creation for mankind. You know, and that's true. God created this, even what it says in Genesis, you know, he put the stars in the heaven for what? For signs, for the moedim, the appointed times. So that when people see the stars, they know what season it is. You know, and all the things God gave, so we know winter and summer. Like people can, you know, test when's the winter solstice and the summer solstice and all of that, so they can know when it's time to plant and all those things that God gave us that are out there. God made those for us. God doesn't need to know, you know, when it's going to be winter time. God doesn't need to know, you know, the seasons and all that. God knows everything. He put those there for us. God already knows. So when I got out there, you know, the Lord was telling me I made everything for man. You know, this is my creation. And so Romans chapter 1, you know, people are without excuse. People know that there is a God besides it's written in their heart already from birth to know right from wrong. The moral law is already in people's heart. The general main things, like I said, murder, rape, etc., so stealing, something like that. It's in our hearts, you know. And then it says people without excuse when they see the creation, what God made. You know, God gave us, you know, think about this. All the different flowers. Look at the beauty of flowers like roses, carnations, etc. The smell of these flowers, okay. When we eat food, if you have food that stinks, it's gone bad, it's rancid, you know, you have some ground beef or something. It may even look all right. You smell it. It smells rotten. It's no coincidence that when milk has gone bad, it stinks. When food spoils, it smells bad. This is no coincidence. God made it that way. You know, back in the days before people had refrigerators, when people didn't have, you know, scientists or doctors telling them don't eat this and do eat that and all that, God already put it in there with the smell, with the taste, all of these things, the way it looks. You see a fruit turns like an apple turns brown or whatever, then it gets, it's no mistake that these things happen, that it changes colors, it doesn't look right, it doesn't smell right. All these things, God did all of those little details that we take for granted for our benefit. I mean, think about the different taste of all the veggies, the different taste of fruits, the looks, all of them look different, taste different. All these beautiful, you know, smells and taste of any kind of fruits and veggies, and even, you know, God gave us cows for milk and for meat and all that thing, all those things. Think about that. Think about, you know, the taste of ground beef or a steak or whatever. God gave us all these things. So all these people that are like, you know, there's nothing wrong with people being a vegetarian or whatever, but you know, them, a lot of these people who are new age, tree hugging, hippie vegetarians, it's because they equate animals with mankind. And that's just like, you know, gay marriage. All of those things are to go up against what, you know, against God's creation. So I just want to say this. I'm thinking about those people who, you know, in Adam and Eve, if you read the Bible, it appears that Adam and Eve were vegetarians and all the people were vegetarians. It appears. It doesn't say that for sure, but it appears to be true. At least till the fall, that's true. There's no death until the fall of man. And then God actually did it himself. He provided these, you know, animal hides for them to wear. So what happened to the meat? Did they eat it or whatever? Was it given to God? But for sure, when Noah, after the flood, God told Noah, he added, you know, that the animals will fear you and the animals are given unto you to eat. And before that, he told Adam and Eve, you know, the fruits and all this stuff is given for you to eat. So when you read that plain reading of the text, I think the basic theological agreement is that from Adam and Eve until after the flood, people were vegetarians. And it, definitely during the time of the garden, before the fall of man. Maybe between the fall of man and the flood. But definitely after the flood, God gave the commission to Noah and said that, you know, you can, you know, you, animals will be afraid of you and you can eat animals for sure after the flood. So anyway, small, unimportant to do with this video, but God gave all these things for our pleasure. God doesn't need to eat a steak. God doesn't need to, God gave them to us. God gave everything. God even gave Eve to Adam for a helpmate, for a companion, you know, for someone to love, to be with, all those things. And that's why the Bible says marriage is honorable in all and the marriage bed undefiled. That's why when you talk about gay marriage, when you talk about adultery, or in this case, not really adultery, you're talking about fornication, particularly sex outside of marriage, whether it be gay sex or any kind, even between a man and a woman, it goes right up against what God laid out in the very beginning in the basic rules of God. That it'd be one man and one woman, you know, and what God has joined together, let no man tear apart, you know, and people say Adam is the one saying that, you know, in the text. Most scholars say, you know, Adam is the one saying that when God gives him Eve. And that's what he's saying. But anyway, brothers and sisters, so I've laid out all those things. So I go out there and then the Lord's like, look at the trees. Do you notice something about the trees? And I was like, you know, I was like, what, Lord? And the Lord is like, look at them. Except for something like Christmas trees, okay? There is an exception to this. The Lord said almost all trees, except for like white pines or blue spruces. Look at, and I was in this area with all these trees. The Lord's like, look at those trees. Where do the branches begin? Where do branches begin on a tree? And I was looking at them. I was like, I don't know. I guess the average tree, the branches begin at like 6 feet or something, maybe 6 feet high. Then the branches start coming up. And the Lord's like, exactly. You know, and how tall are people? I was like, yeah, I guess, you know, the average height is actually less. Like for a man, it's like 5'9" or 5'10" or something maybe in America. And Lord, that's right. So the Lord was telling me, it's just so simple. It's something I never even thought about. It's like the Lord made trees except for like pine trees or some Christmas trees, not all pine trees. Carolina pine that we have here, the branches are way up high near the top. As a matter of fact, they're 20 feet or 30 feet up. But trees have a space from the ground till about 6 feet or so before there's any branches. So if you were walking through the woods and all the trees have branches down to the ground, well, you couldn't walk through the woods. You know, you'd run into the tree branches, but the Lord made almost all of them were the average, you know, tree branches above human height. And he made that small detail on purpose for us. I never even thought about it, never heard that. You know, as I mentioned about the different flowers and meats and all that, that's something that people might think of, you know, the beautiful mountains, you know, the sunrise, sunset, the oceans, the birds singing in the morning and, you know, whatever. All these awesome things that God gave us, the creation. You imagine this is a fallen world, but it's already awesome compared to hell, of course. It's awesome compared to what it could be. Look at all the great, beautiful things that God gave us, but even the smallest detail. And that's what the Lord wanted me to convey to you, that even the details God planned out. I mean, think about it. Think about where man tries to mess this up, like with chemtrails, all these things that man tries to do to mess up what God did. Even the Lord is just saying, you know, even look at my antimicrobial soap that people use, antimicrobial stuff to clean their stuff. But yet there is good microbials. There is probiotics. There is good microbials. bacteria and there's bad bacteria. So when man intervenes and uses an antimicrobial hand soap and kills all the bacteria, even the good bacteria, actually they open themselves up for the bad bacteria to overgrow and cause an infection and cause sickness. So what man, it seems like there's nothing man can do but mess up what God made, you know, to like chemtrails, as I mentioned, is probably one of the biggest ones, to mess with God's creation, with God, the divine order that God made. So, and this is what the Lord is just telling me now. As an example, you're talking about gay marriage. You're talking about sex outside of marriage. You're talking about all these things that people do, all kinds of, you know, S&M, bestiality, whatever you want to talk about that people do. Chemtrails. You can talk about all the GMO of food. All these things that man does to pervert and twist and GMO, genetically modified, you know, changing the DNA sequence of wheat so it can kill bugs, you know, to build in a pesticide into the wheat. Can you imagine? God made a DNA of wheat and then you start changing it. And what people don't even know is I mentioned a video earlier, a while back. I just saw that just like last year, they discovered a whole new sequence like DNA underneath the DNA, a whole nother sequence. So in other words, if DNA was two-dimensional, which it's not, but say you're looking at a two-dimensional picture of the double helix of DNA, it's just like binary, let me say it another way, like binary code for a computer. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Computer has binary code, zeros and ones. And if you could ever add a third number to that, you know, you would multiply the layers just by adding a zero, one, and a two. So computers use binary code, and look what all they could do. If they make it trinary code, make it polynary, whatever you want to call it, code, then it would just, you know, exponentially multiply the ability of computers. So the same thing is true with this new, they don't call it DNA, they call it something else. You're going to have to use the Google if you want to know what it is. But a whole nother layer that makes it, that does a whole nother thing, they don't even know what it does. Okay? And so there's probably even more beyond that. It's probably infinite layers. It's probably so multi-dimensional that we can't even understand it. And if mankind was to go on, maybe it would take them hundreds of years to figure it out, even with the advance of technology we have. So if you imagine you got some wheat that people are eating, and then you make some little genetic modification so where it's resistant to some mites or whatever that might destroy the crop, you don't even know what that underlying information sequence that you removed that tells it, you know, not to give you cancer. You don't know. You don't know. And so this is where man has perverted everything that God made. So when I talk to this message for non-believers is the heavens declare his glory and the handiwork of God. All people in this world are without excuse that there is a God. When you see a rose that is so beautiful and has a smell that it has, and then when it's gone bad, you can see the petals fall off, it turns dark, it turns black, it shrivels up. It's gone bad. When you have some, you go buy some ground beef at the grocery store, it's all reddish, pinkish, you know, and you can see it right there. It is. The fat is clearly able to see how much fat's in it because it's white. There it is. And then when it turns, you get that ground beef out, and the man put an expiration date on there that says April the 28th, whatever. But then you see that it's turned brown. Then you open it up and smell it, and it smells bad. So even though man said, hey, this ground beef is good for two more days, and you put it in the refrigerator, but it's already gone bad. You don't need man to tell you anything. You know, because God put it in your nose to know that it smells bad. I mean, think about it at a whole nother level. We're talking about like the DNA. Think about this, brothers and sisters. Who died and said that rotten meat smelt bad? How is it that it smells bad to us? Why doesn't rotten smell good to us, right? I mean, can you understand what I'm saying? I mean, God made rotten smell rotten to us. It doesn't smell, oh, that smells great. You know, so God gave us the ability to smell all these smells, and then our brain says, this smells bad, that smells good. This smells delicious, this smells like something you shouldn't eat. It smells good, but you shouldn't eat it, like a flower. You smell the tulips, smells great. It smells like perfume, but it's not a smell that, ooh, it makes you hungry, right? Think about it. God put it in you that when you smell that grilling, people's going to get hungry and go eat after they watch this. You know, you smell a sizzling, you hear a sizzling steak on the grill, you smell it. Or what's the number one food that people would love who love to eat food? Probably bacon. You know, you smell that bacon cooking And it's like, it makes your mouth water. When I smell a tulip, it doesn't make my mouth water, even though it smells good. You can smell perfume, it smells good. It's not going to make your mouth water. But the sizzling bacon, the sizzling steak makes you hungry. Think about it. Think about it, brothers and sisters. God made these things the way they are. You know, people go to the bathroom, it smells because it's bacteria. It's you know, you don't want to eat that. How? Because you know why? Because it smells bad. It's aversion to you. So that's why when the world says, oh, he's homophobic. Oh, he's afraid. Phobia is to fear. You know, he's homophobic. He's afraid of homosexuals. You know, an irrational, you know, phobia meaning like a mental disease. I have homophobia because I have a mental disease of being afraid of homosexuality. No. God, and I'm not just picking on people because I have people that watch me who are overcoming homosexuality. And I know they understand this. As they say, you know, hate the sin and love the sinner. We have an aversion. If you're a Christian or even a non-Christian, that's what they're trying to, this is really what I should have called the video. And you'll see where the Lord is leading this. It's like the chemtrails. You know, man is perverting something that God made good. When God made the creation, he called it good. And man tries to pervert the things of God. So when I, even if I wasn't a Christian, before I was a Christian, here I'm a regular guy going down the street, and then there's a homosexual that wants to, you know, proposition me to have homosexual sex with him, as an example, just to say that happened, I would have an urge to flee from that. Not because I'm afraid of this guy or afraid of, you know, the act of homosexuality. It's an aversion to me. Because God put it in me that would be an aversion to me. Now, there are people, as an example, let me say this too, and this is really, you know, let's get down to it on these topics. Like stealing. We all are born with the knowledge that stealing is wrong, but people steal, right? So that's an example. So I want to say this, sin is sin. So, but we have to overcome our desires. So someone says, oh, I was born gay. I can't help it, so I'm gay. And then I say to him, well, I was born with the desire to rob banks. So I think I'll go rob banks. And then you can't condemn me for it because I was born that way. You know, I was born this way. What's her name? Lady Gaga, you know, I can't help it because I was born this way. And that's the meaning of her song, right? As you're born this way, but we're all born with a sin nature, but different sins, right? I mean, you know, some people are born with a desire. They're a kleptomaniac. They want to steal. Some people are born. And you know, like I said, a desire that they want to practice homosexuality or, you know, some people say it was because they had an overbearing mother, whatever. Sometimes these are true. Someone was molested, then they became gay. I mean, these things also happen too. There's other reasons, other environmental factors in people's lives that could make them be a thief too. You know, maybe they were taught the materialism. You know, they keep watching these Nike Air Jordan commercials and they go shoot someone for their Nike Air Jordans or their 8-ball jacket. That was a thing back in the 80s or whatever. In like Chicago and stuff, they were killing someone for a jacket. But the problem with that, not just being a thief, but they had bought into this materialistic hype that also came from the man, from this guy named Bernays, who's the father of, you know, the brainwashing of commercials. That's a whole other thing of materialism. That really made America what it is. You know, he's the one that got women to start smoking. He did a whole campaign to double the cigarette market with getting women to smoke. I think his name is Edwin or Edward Bernays. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God has given us all these things that we're without excuse. So if I go, I'm a grown person and I've been around, right? And I get some hamburger that I bought it at the store and it doesn't expire for 2 more days, but it's brown. I open it up. It stinks. And then I go ahead and eat it. Then I'm without excuse if I get sick because I already knew from what God created that it turned bad. It started smelling bad. It looked bad. You know, it walks like a duck, talks like a duck, and quacks like a duck. It must be a duck, right? So, you know, to go back to a little Watergate reference there, but it's we're without excuse, brothers and sisters. We're without excuse because we know what's written in our heart. Besides even the Christianity and the Word of God and all that, I'm talking about just for non-believers and Christians to look at the basics. Without even the Bible, we're without excuse in all of these things, brothers and sisters. So if you have a desire to do some sin, you know, the Bible says, you know, don't think it's strange because everyone has a desire to do sin. But don't let sin overcome you. You know, don't let it, you know, it says, and I can never quote this Bible verse right, but it says, basically, I'll paraphrase it, you know, that lust begins with a thought. And then when that, you know, conceived with a thought, and then as that thought grows, and, you know, we entertain it, then it births into sin. Whether it be, and that's the, like, pornography is probably the perfect example of this topic. You know, you have a desire to look at pornography. Then once you look at it, you're putting those vain imaginations in your head. And it grows and grows and grows till it births into fornication, adultery, if you're married, whatever. You know, it births to go greater and greater into sin, as one example, brothers and sisters. So we're without excuse. We're without excuse. And God has made these great things for us. And so in 2003, what the Lord showed me about trees, if I can remember off the top of my head to say it right here. But at that time, I had stopped doing the Filipino, one of the Filipino groups I had. I handed it over to a Filipino preacher. And then that was before I started. I'd done two groups. And I'd left both those groups because I was getting ready. No, I wasn't getting ready to go to the Philippines. That was 2003. But I'd left those groups and was really focusing on my school and stuff, because I was in school at the time, Bible school. And then I wasn't going to start another group, but the Lord led me to start another group. But before I did, there was like a month or 2 months where I wasn't really doing hardly any ministry. I had a radio program I'd quit to focus on my school and all this, and I was really feeling down about it because I wanted to preach. But I felt that's what the Lord was leading me to do. So I was out there in the woods running. This was in North Carolina. I was at that time I was running, and that's the time the Lord spoke to me. And the Lord said, see these trees right here. This was in February, almost about the 1st of March. So there was no leaves on the tree and all that, and except for the evergreen trees. And the Lord said, see these trees? Are these trees dead? And I was like, no, Lord, those trees aren't dead. He said, that's right. They're in a season of dormancy. They're in a dormant season right now. So on the outside, they look like they're dead. I mean, look at bark. It's pretty ugly, you know, except for a few trees like crepe myrtles or something. Most trees look dead when you look at them. You know, the bark, no leaves. But the Lord said, no, inside is still life. The sap, the oil, the anointing, the Holy Spirit is still inside like us. So we are like that. And there's the seasons where we bloom and put forth our leaves. And we do the bear the fruit. Like a fruit tree, we bear the fruit. And, you know, even like hickory trees, they have hickory nuts. There's pecan trees. They're not all fruit like we think about apple or whatever. But they all bear their fruit in due season, brothers and sisters. That was a whole other lesson that the Lord gave me in 2003 about trees. And there was a lot more to it. I'd written it down in my prayer journal. It's somewhere in my storage, I think, here in the States. It could be in the Philippines. I forgot. But anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. I want to pray for you guys. I want to ask the Lord to bless you and keep you and let his face to shine upon you and give you his peace and give you his rest. So I want to pray for you right now. Father, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, hallelujah, Lord God, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God, I ask you to bless your people right now. I decree the blessings to come from the north, the south, and the east, and the west. Overtake that people, Lord God. Father, I ask you to bless your people, Lord, with the blessings, hallelujah, that you gave Israel. Hallelujah, they'd be the head and not the tail. They would be blessed going in and coming out. Hallelujah, that they would have dew. They would have the dew of the morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. That they would have the early rain and the latter rain, Lord God. Lord, just pour out your blessings upon them, Lord, of health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, and love. Lord God, they would walk in the patriarchal anointing of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph, Lord God. Of health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, and love. In the name of Jesus, they would have an overflowing abundance, Lord God. They would have houses they didn't build, wells they didn't dig, vineyards they didn't plant. Hallelujah, Lord God. Lord, just open up the windows of heaven over your people, Lord God. Open up the windows of heaven over your people, Lord, according to your promises in Malachi 3:10, Lord God. Open up the windows of heaven and pour them out blessings they cannot contain, Lord God. Lord, let them be fruitful and multiply. Hallelujah, Lord God, and replenish this nation, this world with thy gospel, Lord God. Let the earth be replenished with the gospel from the mouths of your people, Lord God. Hallelujah, Father, we give you the praise and the glory right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, and I would remind you that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Every tongue that rises up against thee, thou shalt condemn. This is the inheritance of the saints of God, and their righteousness is of me, saith the Lord. Isaiah 54:17. Hallelujah. Praise God. Blessings. Hallelujah. Praise God through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. For God is good all the time. And all the time God is good. And he is always and forevermore worthy of all praise and glory. And even as the heavens and this earth declares his glory. Hallelujah. God bless you all, brothers and sisters. I'm going to make that slideshow. Those of you who are interested, I also posted in the Facebook group and on the website about the orphans and updates and all that, all the things, the needs. As the school starts back there at the beginning of June, so we prepare for the school children. They need new uniforms. They need all the school supplies, all those things. We need new mattresses. We use mattress pads there at orphanages. They all need new toothbrushes and all those things, brothers and sisters. We need to get some new vehicle. We need to get another motorcycle with a sidecar for one of the orphanages. So, brothers and sisters, ask for you to prayer. We got a van we need to sell and use that money. We need to do a lot of painting. And all the orphanages need painting in the ceilings and all kinds of stuff. New screens. You know, we got a lot of mosquitoes and dengue fever and all that. The screens, you know, the orphans tear up the screens at the orphanage. You know, we need to always constantly repair and replace those kind of things. The doors get broken, doorknobs broken off, doors broken. These orphans are pretty rough because they came from living in huts with no electricity and running water. So for them, you know, it's hard to get them domesticated. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. Have a blessed day.